What? Welcome everybody to The Place to Be. My name is Sean Q, my partner like always,
Jay Roman.
Together we are OSP. We're going to keep a little light this week, this episode. We're going to, you know, we've been going kind of hard in the paint on you. We know we've been digging into you about issues and stuff like that. So we want to talk about something that helps, you know, Jay Roman feel at ease and at peace is when we start chopping it up about Marvel and what's happening in movie theaters in 2020. 2020 is, believe it or not, it's almost over. And the movie theater cinema industry has taken a giant hit because of this pandemic. And we are going to get into some of the things that have to address that. But first and foremost, let's get into what's popping. Here's what's popping. I'm not even going to say it. I'm going to let you do it. Tell people what's popping. I don't give a fuck.
Lakers, baby. Boom, boom, boom. Number 17. Tied with the Boston Celtics, who, you know, who were mad bitter about it. Like, it matters. They won their shit way back when. Number 17, LeBron gets number 4. The debates heat up of greatest of all time, which I'm going to go the Chris Bosh route on this. And say, you know what? Those debates are actually kind of disrespectful. Because at this point, you're talking about two different people in two different eras and a whole lot of other shit going on. Forget the debate at this point. Just give me your top people. Jordan and LeBron are in there. That's all I need to know. To me, it was never a debate, so whatever. But congrats to the Lakers. Number 17, number 4 for LeBron, and number 1 for AD, who may go down as one of the greatest defenders of all time, who used to play point guard, which I didn't know until the finals. And they gave me all this stuff on him because I never watched him when he was with the Pelicans.
Yeah, I swear I told you that. Well, he was a point guard, and then he grew like 73 inches in high school.
73.
But into some.
So he went from an amoeba to a giant.
Pretty much. He was a firm, and then he was a 6'11" center. I'm not. What part of this are you not getting? Congrats to them, whatever, and their bubble victory. I have decided, I'm going to take the route of Doris Burke. Doris Burke was like, I want to stop the whole greatest of all time conversation and just say who was great for their era. And so we can say, Bill Russell was great. Michael Jordan was great. Kobe Bryant, whatever, was great. LeBron is great. And just put it like that. I've seen so many posts since, and I hate it. Especially since we live in California, all the Laker fans are like, what do you think now? What about Jordan now? My opinion has not changed, motherfucker. Different time, different era, different rules, different game. Doesn't matter. Congrats to LeBron for winning another one. The best thing I saw come out of this was there was that whole story about when LeBron was in the bubble, Lil Bronny was out there smoking weed. He got caught. And his son got caught smoking weed and was like, yo, when your dad get out the bubble, he gonna beat your ass. And
what? When you hear this stuff?
Yeah, dude, it was like LeBron posted, he was doing an interview or whatever, and they were like, you know, what about the video about Lil Bronny post smoking weed? And he was like, I'll deal with that later. Everybody's like, ooh, get your ass whipped. The best thing I saw from this was they had a thing, it was like Lil Bronny said it, which you know he didn't, but he was like, my dad can't beat anybody by himself. So unless he walks in the house with AD, I'm fine.
Stupid.
So now, he didn't say that. But if he did, mad props to Lil Bron.
Oh, you a man now.
Oh, you a man now, Bronny? Huh? If he said that, like, yo, my dad ain't beating nobody by himself. So unless Chris Bosh, Dwayne Wade, Anthony Davis, or Kyrie Irving about to walk in the door, anybody scared of that, nigga? I'm sure he didn't say. I'm pretty sure.
Where do you find this stuff?
I don't know. Oh, man. It is a funny place.
Oh, man.
We were talking about theaters. Like, have you been to the movies in 2020? You have, right? Like, beginning of the year, you went.
I went hard, man.
The last movie you saw in a theater in 2020?
I don't remember because it's a mix. It was two action flicks or whatever. I can't remember which one was the last, but I want to say it was the first week in March. And I probably wouldn't have even gone if they had made it serious and told us how serious it all was. But then when I did go, it was kind of nice because I think I've said this before. I like going by myself. And I go at certain times where sometimes I'm the only one in the theater. Right. So when I was there for that last one, I was like maybe one of two or three people in the theater. So it was a whole thing to myself. I'm chilling, lounging, you know, probably farting. Who knows at that point? Just like doing what I got to do because I'm by myself, you know? So I don't remember. But all theaters have been closed except actually for the Irvine Spectrum. They have their Regal open. They're still showing IMAX, old films and all that. I'm like, wait. You shut down all your theaters in the UK and the U.S., except for the Spectrum. I'm sure there's probably one or two more open, but it's kind of crazy. So no more movies going for the rest of the year. I want to hermetically seal myself and go to the movies because I want to see something on the big screen.
I actually did go see something, which we'll get into in a second. But
I know.
One of the movies, like all the big blockbusters that were supposed to come out this year. I remember 2020 was supposed to be the blockbuster year, the summer 2020. You know what's about to happen? All kinds of shit's coming out. Summer 2020. We're about to have The Last Bond with Daniel Craig. We're supposed to have all kinds of shit happen, and all of that shit got pushed back. So the movie I saw is one of the reasons why Black Widow got pushed back. The last movie I saw, I went and saw Tenet in theater. I saw because AMC, when they did their reopen, last month, they had the seats. I think they still do have the seats socially distanced. So
yeah,
it's hard as shit to get a seat because you'll be like, I want to sit right there. And you're like, well, you can't because there's a guy who's sitting three seats over and he just got the seats in front. You're like, all right, cool. So there's eight people in the theater, which like you, I'm cool with. I'm cool not having a packed theater. You know, it's funny. Last time I think we both went to a theater that was packed. It was like, I don't know if it was Matrix or Star Wars. It was something. And we went like opening weekend, like some dumbasses. And it was like, that's when we start realizing we might be getting too over this opening weekend shit.
Yeah.
Because I remember just the look on our faces when they're hitting the beach ball and everybody's screaming and shit. We was like, no, shut the fuck up. We were like the minority version of the two old dudes and the Muppets. Just like, hey, shut the fuck up. The movie's on.
I do remember Matrix having the guy dressed as Neo and his long trench and all that. So I think that could have been it. I don't remember exactly the last one.
Yeah, it was though. Just, I remember the beach ball was going on. I was like, yo, man, we're never doing this again. We're never doing this.
You brought up Bond, and Bond actually apparently was the dagger in the coffin for 2020 movie theaters.
Mm.
So Bond was, once that got pushed back, that's when Regal was like, oh, we're out. We're cutting everything off. And then, I learned Irvine is still open, so I might try to sneak in. But who knows?
You know, they show it. That was one of those. And the Bond thing is a big deal because, like I said, it's supposed to be Daniel Craig's last one. And I'm going to put this out of order. I have been having debates at work with patrons and stuff. And the thing was posed out there, the two final candidates for the next Bond have been announced. And do you know who they are? Do you know who the two final candidates are?
Let me put it like this. I've never seen a single Bond film.
Wait, like any of them?
None.
You haven't seen one Bond movie? 007, no Sean Connery, Roger Moore, Timothy Dalton, Pierce Brosnan, Daniel Craig. What the fuck? Well, this is it. Our old school perspective is trash. Shut it down. Not one, my nigga? Not one.
Nope. Though the only one I caught a glimpse of was a Pierce Brosnan one. He was in a tank, and it was too corny and cheesy for me to take. I was like, I can't take this.
It was like, Tomorrow Never Dies. Really?
Yep.
Who are these people out here not watching? There was another dude who was like, I've never seen one of them. Like, who's out here not watching Bond movies? Damn. Okay. Well, then this means nothing to you. Do you understand the iconic character that is Bond? Do you understand his?
I do. He's a super spy, but why do they keep renaming the character, the movies? So
here's the thing, and this is the conversation I was having. My good friend Pat was like, I feel like they should do with Bond what they're doing with like these comic book movies and comic book shows, and they should have like all the old Bonds pop up in one of the newer ones. Okay. And I was trying to explain to him that they can't because Bond is kind of like Batman in that it is the retelling of certain stories over generations with a different character. Yeah. So the minute you introduce an older Bond, then you cross those stories and it fucks up the whole thing.
Yeah. So
basically what they do is they say to a director or a writer or whatever, all right, we want to bring Bond into the 21st century. Give us some spy shit that's happening in the 21st, like Tom Clancy type stuff.
Yeah.
And you know, we'll pick a Bond for it and we'll give him like 2-3 movies to run with it. And so the two candidates they have right now to play Bond are Tom Hardy, and the guy who I'm not a fan of, Super Witcher Sherlock Holmes, fucking Superman Henry Cavill.
Interesting. Okay.
Yeah. So
I wouldn't have thought either one of those.
That's because you haven't seen a Bond movie, so it wouldn't make sense to you.
Okay.
The older Bond movies, like with Sean Connery, the thing that people got about Bond was, you know, he's real debonair, he's real suave, and he, you know, he's a pretty boy. When you get to Pierce Brosnan, like, I think Pierce Brosnan was the last pretty boy.
Yeah, he was super pretty. Everyone loved it.
And that was the thing. It's a pretty boy who drinks martinis and blends in everywhere. And then they bring in Daniel Craig to make it a little bit grimier, to where there's more fight scenes. So when you had the earlier Bonds, there wasn't a lot of fight scenes. It was a lot of gadgetry, a lot of spy stuff, a lot of, you know, meetings in secret places and stuff like that. And then they brought in Daniel Craig and they're like, yo, let's start whipping this dude's ass. What if what if Bond started fighting these dudes who know parkour and they just fucked his old ass up? And it kind of changed the genre, and I liked it. I was talking to an old school cat this earlier this week. He was like 50, 60. He was like, yeah, I don't like the Daniel Craig guy. I mean, he doesn't look like Bond. I'm like, yeah, but that's what they were going for. They weren't going for a pretty boy.
Yeah.
They were going for somebody who can, you know, get rugged, get down and dirty. Yeah. I mean, there's a scene, the dude jumps off a train that's falling apart and fixes his suit that's covered in dirt and shit. Like, I'm bomb.
I think I'm going to try and get into the Daniel Craig ones and just leave it at those.
See, my thing is, I feel like you should at least do like one Pierce Brosnan. Not that Tomorrow Never Dies. Do GoldenEye. GoldenEye was so good that it produced one of the greatest video games of all time. Watch GoldenEye with Pierce Brosnan just to see like the concept of Bond and see how he's a pretty boy. That way you can compare it and contrast it with Daniel Craig's. Now, the conversation I was having with this guy is I was like, Tom Hardy or Henry Cavill? Henry Cavill fits the moniker of the older Bonds. He's a giant pretty boy. He'll blend in wherever he has this stupid accent and blah, 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 blah. Tom Hardy... is more, dude. I don't like that this dude's that you can't be Superman and Sherlock Holmes and the fucking Witcher and James Bond. Like, come on, bro. Are they running out of white boys in Hollywood? The last I checked, there was no white boy shortage in Hollywood.
Yeah, I don't know.
But the Henry Cavill thing. Go ahead.
Yeah, no, I'm saying can't call it. I don't. It's just to me like so they decided not to go with a black guy again. Okay.
Yeah. You know. Well, I mean, I like Trevor Noah's take on why they can't do a black guy. Trevor Noah was like, they can't have Idris Elba because Bond travels around the world and outside of certain parts, the world is mainly white. You know what I mean? So if Idris Elba is running in Switzerland from these dudes, you're like, oh, there he is. Yeah. Oh, he jumps off a building, he comes off a car.
I'll give him that, but they do it in other movies and it's not a problem. You just make it
what
it is. Yeah,
but it's not the iconic character.
What if it's like, what if you do like Bond in Africa then at this point?
See, but that's the thing. That's one movie.
It has to be that bad. Yeah,
but that's the thing is that's one movie. You would have
to. But Africa's huge. You can make a dozen movies out of Africa.
Right, but you can't do a trilogy that's just like, we got to stay in Africa because Bond is black. That's not really a Bond thing.
I mean, he could come to America. He could be in America.
He could. And I feel like they could find ways around it. They just don't want to put that pressure on the writer. So, like, give us a white boy, a pretty white
boy. I got the idea. He comes to America, and a couple of white cops say, hey, we need to see your ID. And he'll say in his funny accent, but why? Or whatever, right? And he says, okay. And they say, but I'm Bond. And then he'll whip their ass and he'll leave. You know what I mean? I don't know. Something leave. Like that.
And just make it up. Right. And it's a social justice movie. And it's like, you know what? You know what? Black Bond is right. I'm going to go fuck me a cop up. That's why they can't do that. If Black Bond could be out here whipping cops' ass, maybe y'all could do it. That's why they won't allow that. But I don't like the Henry Cavill. I mean, Henry Cavill fits the moniker, the older pretty boy one. And Tom Hardy's definitely more of the grimy Daniel Craig one. So I guess it depends on what direction they're going in. Yeah. I did throw a caveat in there. I was like, the only problem with getting Tom Hardy is you don't know which Tom Hardy you are getting. Tom Hardy could show up and be like, yeah, I'll do three movies. All right, cool. And on the first set, he was like, all right, I just decided that Bond has a South African accent. And they're like, ah.
Or maybe this Bronson super hard, guttery English accent.
Super pikey, yeah. Oi, oi. Cunts. Come here, Roy. Fuck off. Like, you can't have Bond telling people to fuck off. But that's what you get when you get Tom Hardy. Because remember, like the original Bane in the comic books and in the cartoon was from South America. Like he had a Latin accent. And Tom Hardy was like, no, I think he sounds like an English boxer. I'll go English boxer. That's the dude who can show up to do Bond. They're like, fuck, we got three movies for this fucking dude. Talking like this, fuck. So I feel like you run the risk of having that happen and ruining the franchise if you bring in Tom Hardy. Unless you could be like, look, Tom, use your normal fucking voice, Thomas. Thomas. I don't know. It might go either way. I didn't mean to get off topic. But
well, since now it's turned into a whole Bond episode, it's actually good that you brought up Tom Hardy. Because we want to make this episode more about Marvel stuff because I want to geek out a little bit because the election crap has just, oh my gosh, it's just like making my eyeballs bleed and my ears pop. And it's freaking nuts. But so is the news from Marvel. Not eyeballs bleeding, all that, but it's mind-boggling. So Black Widow got pushed out of 2020. like all these other movies. So the entire MCU phase four is going to start 2021. Whether it's in shows or in the theater, whatever the hell it's going to be, we're still not even sure when we're going to get to start some of these things. So the arrangement of the movies has changed, which is fine, whatever. But some of the biggest issues, and I'm wondering a lot right now if it's because of COVID shutdowns and people just having kind of more time to think and maybe negotiate and stuff like that. Is this why we might get certain things like a Spider-Verse, like a real live Spider-Verse? Because right now, if I'm correct, they have already confirmed that Andrew Garfield and Tobey Maguire have signed on for Spider-Man 3. All right, we already know Venom 2 is coming. Everyone's calling for the crossover. How are you going to do it? I don't know at this point. But Doctor Strange is going to take over Iron Man's role or Tony Stark's role and kind of be that mentor, which I'm really excited for because a lot of people may not remember those comics. Back before Civil War in the comics, Doctor Strange, or maybe not just Strange, but there was a very mystic element to Spider-Man. Right, he was chosen by the ancient gods or whatever, and it's kind of passed down, right? So a lot of people didn't really like that storyline, so they kind of broke off. But when Civil War came out, it was like everyone's back on board. Spider-Man's badass again. Straczynski leaves. Michael J. Straczynski, who was the writer, leaves. 1 second. And then we got a new writer. Anyway, and so they took him away from the mystical part of it, and they kind of made it just more science-y and comic, whatever. So the fact that we may get this part three because they're bringing Doctor Strange in, who's going to have the multiverse of madness, it's kind of an obvious thing. What's really, really cool about it is those two guys are going to be a little older. I'm anxious to see if they're going to keep them older as if they just aged in their own group or in their own movies, or if they are going to digitize their youth a little bit. One thing I'm anxious to see is how Garfield plays, because he didn't do part three. He left. And we were so anxious to see him in part three because they showed all the costumes for the Sinister Six, right, that were coming. They had a couple. So with Maguire and Garfield signing on, and actually even before them, we have Jamie Foxx who signed on to reprise as the Electro.
Right.
Funny thing is, everyone's like, is he going to be blue Electro or is he going to be yellow Electro? It's like, how about you just shut the fuck up? Because what does it matter? I love the blue. It makes sense to me, electricity-wise, whatever. A lot of people want to see the classic yellow color. I don't want his old outfit. I hope they don't do something like that.
If they put Jamie Foxx in those tights, in that tight green and brown, yellow and brown.
And the zappy head.
Yeah.
Like, I hope they don't do that. They may do it as like a little funny thing, kind of like they did with Luke Cage, right? Where they kind of show him that thing in the reflection. Hopefully they don't do something like that. But I love that he's coming back because this is now the first time, besides the Morbius trailer, that we're seeing, they are trying to blend some stuff together. And, of course, J. Jonah Jameson coming back in Far From Home, which was a nice little touch, which I don't like the way he looked in it. I like his older look, but anyway.
Yeah, that's weird.
He looks like a little bit – and maybe because I'm comparing the figures of him, he looks like Mean Gene Oakland to me a little bit too much. You know, and I'm not feeling that look. I want the flat top. I want, like, spiky flat top, you know, big old mustache look.
How do you feel about Spider-Man coming? Well, let me tell you something.
So we don't know what part three is going to be called yet. There's guesses. Well, what we do know is between all the movies, you have a lot of the Sinister Six that have already been there. All right. So here are the original Sinister Six. Original OG members from way back. Doc Ock, Kraven, Electro, Mysterio, Sandman, and Vulture. Okay. Right. Those are the original Sinister Six. There's no Green Goblin. There's no few of other people that have come in and out of the thing, right? We already have Doc Ock. He's already been in there. We already have Electro. We already have Mysterio. We've already had Sandman.
And we've had Vulture.
We only need one more to get the classic original Six. And Kraven is said to be coming. He was already said to be part of Part 3. So they have been – I mean, of course, they always have the planet. So they've been coming for a while. And the fact that they let MCU help and kind of dictate the sequencing, I guess you could say, it's really, I think, helps Sony a lot, because I still don't know what they're doing with Venom. I don't understand what's happening there. But the fact that they have sequentially really led up to Sinister Six, and I think the Spider-Verse is a little bit too soon, but I get why they might be doing it. It's a really fun take. I think it would be pretty great. But the fact that we already have the Sinister Six there, we just need the one more. If it's going to be really Kraven or not, I don't know. Maybe it's going to be his daughter. Maybe it's going to be a relative, something like that. But that would be super dope because that person is, you know, the hunter. He does his thing.
Right.
I was hoping he'd be getting introduced. I think they were talking about possibly, I want to say Black Panther or some shit back in the day.
Yeah.
But that's all changed, obviously.
They were also talking about getting Jason Momoa to do it.
Yeah, well, I don't know if that was real talk or if that was just hype.
Fan trailers.
I don't know if that. So, and they brought Green Goblin in twice already, of course, which the second one I thought was just awful. So, the next news I'm excited about, though, yo, had me hype. You should have seen me on the couch. Velchula was like looking at me like, what the hell's wrong with this guy? Yo, they're talking about Matthew McConaughey as possibly Green Goblin. I don't know how far along they are in the talks. The only concern I have is that damn accent. Don't give me country Green Goblin. I don't want to hear about them haystacks, Green Goblin, okay?
My name is Norman Osborn, and I think you'll be all right.
See, you're pretty good about that. I don't want him to sound like that if he's Norman Osborn, but I think he'd be a dope Green Goblin because he can give you that very straight business look, you know, good looking, and he can give you that fire in his eyes that you need for that madness. You know, I love the idea. Bring that shit, please.
I imagine if a fan made a trailer, which they probably will jump on this as soon as they hear about it, you hit that scene from Wolf of Wall Street when he's talking to Leonardo DiCaprio. You have him in his suit, and you have him chilling, you know, I mean, just Norman Osborn's.
That would be perfect.
That's what I imagine. When you first put that, I imagine, I was like, okay, I can see Matthew McConaughey. I mean, he's a great actor. He could do anything. So I think that would be dope. Plus, I want to see them making Green, like, the veins and shit coming out of his
face. Oh,
like that.
I'm so excited. If that could be happening. Because he apparently has already rejected multiple offers to be in the MCU. You know? So.
You don't know what I've referred to 2020 as. So you know the SAG, the SAG Awards, like the SAG, it's like the Screen Actors Guild.
I've been
calling 2020 the bag. It's the Broke Actors Guild. All these motherfuckers need jobs. And they're like, yeah, I mean, remember all those offers I turned down before because I said I was too good for it, but now I haven't worked in a year. So I'll take whatever you want.
Well, McConaughey isn't like that. He's always been, he's still working, but they all need, you're right, they all need to work, you know, just like we do. We all need to, yeah. I'll take an acting job right now. Why not? Dude, come on, bring the offers.
Listen, only listen, people, OSB fam, the only reason why we're doing this, we're trying to get our own TV show to then get our own movies. We just, listen, this is all a big ploy to be in the MCU. I don't want you to know.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely. Better or the next Matrix. Just throw us in there. You know what I mean? But, hello?
Yeah.
Say something. There you go. Okay. One thing I forgot to mention, they already have Scorpion, who is a part of another version of the Sinister Six, a later version, right? So you already have six people right there without anybody else. You don't need to bring in the original. You don't need to bring in Kraven. You can keep Scorpion. Remember, he showed up with the Vulture at the end of the movie.
Yeah.
Right. So they've already introduced him. So they could bring him on. It'll be really interesting to see that little guy get into like a big old crazy uniform that is supposed to be actually sponsored by J. Jonah Jameson. So we'll see how this goes.
In the Amazing Spider-Man 2, they had fat ass Paul Giamatti as Rhino, and he was like all he was not that ripped up.
It was just his face.
He was in
the machine.
They showed when the mech opened, like he had some kind of muscles. He ain't got no muscles.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, that's so everything's digital. Anybody can look much bigger, stronger, faster, taller than they are. It's all digital. Let's take a break real quick. Let's take it because you're all hot and bothered right now. You're gonna be okay. When you say Matthew McConaughey, he's like, ooh.
I think I skipped over a few things. We gotta go back.
We'll take a break. We'll come back. Keep your eyes open. Keep your ears open.
All right, here we go. My MCU little nerd out right here, putting you on. All the notes I get for MCU stuff, I immediately jot it down because I need to fantasize about these things because y'all already know. You already know how that goes. 2021 is going to be huge. We don't even know when the shows are going to start. We don't know when the movie's going to start. It's all a surprise at this point. So I'm super hyped. And one thing, I don't think I mentioned it earlier already, though. Not only did everything get pushed back, but we're actually going to get a Mr. Chadwick Boseman back in the MCU for a very, very short little thing in the Marvel What If series. You know, he already recorded his lines. I do not remember the storyline. I had the article. I can't seem to find it in my notes. I had it all out, though. He already recorded his lines. So we're going to be able to hear him one more time. I'm probably going to choke up when I hear it.
Completely. Yeah, we all will.
Damn it, that man's gone. So I think that's super, super dope. One thing I don't like, though, I hate any of the What If series comics. I hate them all because they're all whack as hell. Because you know why? Because comics are comics. Every single comic is a What If. Right. You don't need a separate What If. They're all What If. So the fact that there's a separate What If line, I always think they're kind of cheesy. But some cool stuff comes out of them later sometimes because sometimes they keep those characters because they were so popular. You know, like the character Venompool, Deadpool and Venom together, right. Was a What If. But people love the idea so much that they've made he's in the video game. They've made toys. There's multiple comics that still have him somewhere here and there. So it's fun that way. But I just don't like the idea of What If because people want to mix it up sometimes. And like, why? So what if Captain America won the Civil War and Tony Stark died instead? Oh, then we have Civil Warrior. That's super dope. But then that storyline doesn't continue. So to me, it's like, I don't care then.
It's, you know, more of a, I actually like the What If because I remember a comic book I read when I was a kid. I don't know where it was. It was some crossover. It was fucking giant. And it was basically a giant What If, and it was a crossover. So it was like, what if Wonder Woman and Captain Marvel had a fight, and what if, and it was something like that. It was like a versus series. But I like the What If because it does give you a different perspective on something without having to do a continuous storyline of it. Yeah. That way you can just be like, what if, and then imagine that, and we'll go from here. We're not going to throw off our whole storyline. We're not going to change everything. Just what if Captain America did win? Okay, cool. Yeah. Wouldn't that be cool? Let's get back to where we were. You know what I mean? That way you don't have to branch off and do a whole thing. Then it gets confusing. I think it's dope that we're going to hear Mr. Bozeman one more time as Black Panther. I think everybody who watches is going to choke up a little bit. And on the Black Panther note, the people, ever since he passed, the people were like, so what happens to Black Panther 2? Is it going to be Princess Shuri? Is it going to be, what are they going to do? And then all the, you know, what's happening in 2020, the way things happen now is once the fan theory gets put out there, a lot of these studios, especially Kevin Feige, he loves to be that guy, like give the people what they want. They were like, so, and somebody said it, they were like, so if the world changed because of the snap that Thanos created, then there's a chance to bring Killmonger back. And they were like, is there a chance? And they asked Michael B. Jordan. He was like, if there's a chance to bring Killmonger back, yeah, I'm definitely down. I'm going to do it. And the people were like, how do we make that happen? So I don't know. I'm very curious to see what direction they take with Black Panther 2.
I got you on that. I got how they're going to bring Killmonger back. Go. So technically, Killmonger can't come back because of the snap, because he died. He actually died. The snap, it's like, almost everyone was in some kind of weird dusty limbo. It was weird.
Right.
There is a storyline where Killmonger comes back and becomes Black Panther. There is a storyline in the comics already written that if they can go, they can go canon on that bad boy. They can just take it straight from there because it involves two other villains. One that brings back Killmonger back to life, and this magician guy. It's a very, very convoluted story. So you'd have to read it on your own. I'm not going to explain the whole damn thing. It's kind of crazy. But he does come back. Everyone wants, though, I think, the Shuri line where she becomes it, right? So part of what I heard, what could be nice is she becomes it, but then Killmonger, who comes back, they kind of do form an alliance.
Right.
He becomes Black Panther, so then she can save Queen and just be the queen that she needs to be.
Right.
But I would love to see Shuri as the badass Black Panther because that's straight up from the comic too, and that would be super dope. I mean, why not? And so far, that's what I hear they're going towards. But there is a story, though, when Killmonger comes back. And when Bozeman died, the only thing I thought, the only one I'd want to see as Black Panther is Michael B. Jordan, but he already played Killmonger.
Right.
So, I don't know.
My opinion on that has changed. Like, I like Michael B. Jordan as an actor, but I've been watching some things. Like, I just watched between the guy who played Dr. Manhattan in the Watchmen series, who I think could play Black Panther.
Oh, easy. Right? And easy then I've pick, been
watching.
Yeah.
I've been watching Lovecraft Country, and I thought that dude would be a great Black Panther, but they already have plans for him. He's already said to do something big because everybody saw him like, "Yo, who is this dude? He's got the build. He can act. Mm-hmm. Oh, we got to put him to it." So he's already signed on. So I thought there were other people, but now that aside from the Dr. Manhattan dude, Michael B. Jordan doing it, I'm with it
because I'm with all that.
So I mean, I like that there are good, more leading Black actors coming up who can play these roles and push the genre forward. I'm a fan of it. I don't know if you saw, first of all, to the people who, It doesn't even happen much on our page, but it definitely happens on my page where people who know me are like, hey, I want to come on your podcast and debate you on this. Explain something to you people. First of all, no.
Second of all. No. Are you scared? Hold on. No. Are you ready for some tough questions? You're supposed to say no, because that's what the president said.
No. Give me the easy questions we discussed earlier. No, I'm not. Just so we're clear on this, I'm not afraid to debate anybody on my opinions. It's my opinion, and you have your opinion. However, I don't know why you feel the OSP podcast is the outlet for you to come and debate me personally for something I said that offended you. I don't get that. No, you can't come here and debate me on it. Oh, I want to debate. Okay,
it's all in fun. It's all in fun.
I know, dude. There's a reason why the two of us do this show. You and I, what we do with this show is this is stuff that you and I would talk about if nobody was around.
Yeah.
We just thought it would be dope to bring the people in. And then it's grown from there. And I love that the people have jumped on board. I love that we have followers. I love that people want to hear this conversation. But I don't know how many people hit up Stephen A. Smith like, I would like to debate you on your MMA remarks. Because I'm sure Stephen No.
Yeah.
No, that's fun though. I invite the conversation. I invite the questions. We're still waiting to hear some feedback on my Cobra Kai comments, but keep in mind, people, it was just that. My opinion and my comments. By all means, throw me your opinion. But you're not about to come on the show and debate me. This ain't some LL Cool J jumping on stage with Houdini. Like, what the fuck are you? No. It ain't going down the stage. This ain't some Joe Rogan jumping on stage with Carlos Mencia. I'm not going to let you come to my platform and try to make me look bad. The fuck I look like. Anyway, one of those topics was that DC announced that they were going to bring back Jared Leto to reprise his role of Joker in the Justice League Zack Snyder cut. I have to say it the right way every time.
JLZ.
Yeah, right. JLZ. I
guess.
Whatever. Which a lot of people aren't happy with because they still call him the worst Joker. He's the worst Joker.
My question, what's he going to do there? I don't remember being there a Joker in the last one.
That's the thing. The Zack Snyder cut is supposed to be, I don't know, a 7-hour movie So they're going to have his character in there. I mean, because Ben Affleck's Batman was in Suicide Squad.
Yeah.
So obviously, it's the same universe. So it's probably some scene. Basically, Zack Snyder, once he got that extra money, he's like, cool, let me throw all kinds of D shit in there. DC shit in there.
D shit. Like D-list actors.
Right? Messed up. Well, no, his thing was like, he was like, because I'm not going to make another one, because I'm not going to make a part two, he had a plan for a Justice League 2.
Yeah. Okay.
So what he's going to do is he's going to try to incorporate it all into one Snyder cut. And one of those things he included was he reached out to Ryan Reynolds and was like, hey, would you like to reprise your least favorite role in the DC universe again? He asked Ryan Reynolds to be the Green Lantern again for from his movie. And everybody's just like, oh dear God, Zachary, what are you doing?
So I wouldn't mind that, but I mean, I would just picture it like they would do with Batman. Like they did with Batman versus Superman, where it's just like a glimpse of him. Like he's there, but he's not in the movie.
I think what they're doing is they're trying to do like a Crisis on Infinite Earths type thing to where they show like a scene that affects all of the DC universe. Yeah. And it'll be like Green Lantern standing over like this. So to get Ryan Reynolds to come in, get all dressed up and go, to me is a waste of Ryan Reynolds' talent.
Yeah. Hey, I mean, people have done less, right?
Once again, broke-ass actors in 2020.
I mean, I don't mind. I'm one of the few that didn't mind the Jared Leto Joker. I did find myself questioning why this character, but I worked with this guy who that's his favorite version of Joker. And I'm like, really? Of all the Jokers, like, he is your favorite version? He's like, yeah. I'm like, the gangster, like the mobster. He's like, yeah. There's just something the way he goes about it. I was like, that is so weird. You're the only person I've ever met that is the favorite Joker of yours. Like out of all of them, it's nuts. I don't know. I mean, my thing is, are we ever going to see the Phoenix Joker crossover into any of the actual films? Because they set it all up. Like, there should be, especially with how dark they are, Pattinson could definitely run into that Joker. I mean, come on. What's up? I guess
it depends on the timeline, because that Joker looks like it was set in the 70s.
True. Which, if that's the case,
they would have to make Phoenix old as shit.
Yeah.
That's the only problem that I had with that one. The only reason why I don't think we would get that Joker is because it was set in the 70s. And even
maybe that Joker would have to meet the Michael Keaton Batman and they'd be that age again, like, yeah, whatever.
Kinda, yeah, it would be like a whole That's thing. I don't think they would do it. Which would be great chemistry. I mean, Joaquin Phoenix and Michael Keaton on screen together just sounds like beautiful weirdness. So I'm with it.
Okay.
I don't care if they just stare at each other for 8 minutes. I'd watch it. It seems
weird enough. Okay.
You wanted to stick in DC. I saw what's happening. We were speaking about it's dope that we were talking about Michael B. Jordan from Marvel. Mm-hmm. And what DC's doing. I don't know if a lot of people remember Static Shock. I used to watch Static Shock. Mm-hmm. You used to watch. You probably know more about Static Shock than I do.
Yes and no. So I watched it a little bit, but then I stopped because it kind of went away. I didn't know where it went. Turns out after I watched the documentary, and I watched the documentary years ago, so my memory is not as keen on it right now. Static Shock was a huge deal for DC and for Warner Brothers, right? And it was doing really well, and it was kind of an independent, but yet because they weren't getting the audience, and this is also in the time that DC or the comics were in the toilet, like they were in turmoil. Marvel and DC almost went down completely. Publishers were losing, you know, licensing and going bankrupt like crazy. So Static Shock comes along, and it's like, oh, there's a black superhero, and he's the main guy. This is what's up. And it was more like an indie guy. An indie, if I'm remembering the right character, it's an independent label type thing that DC took on. Like, okay, let's try this. But then they disbanded them because there was internal strife with the comic creators, and DC just couldn't seem to be able to push it all out. Plus, they got a little risky. I think I'm talking about the right one. If I'm not, please someone get at me on that article, the biography that I saw. I just can't remember what it was. But
I remember the show on the WB, the cartoon.
Yeah, so the comic, though, got kind of crazy, if I'm thinking of the right comic. So besides that, though, you're bringing up the fact that Bozeman and Michael B. Jordan, not Bozeman, but Reginald, yeah, actually, Bozeman, there's kind of a connection there. So they both played in the Black Panther movie. Reginald Hudlin wrote Black Panther comics in the earlier 2000s, and it was phenomenal. They were phenomenal issues. Some of my favorites in all the comics I own. So it's pretty dope that they are now putting a Static Shock movie together. Mm. And of course, what does that mean? Static Shock, like merch and comics are going through the roof cost wise. And it's like, oh, I could have got one a long time ago. But I never sought it out. So I'm not going to be a poser like that. Like, oh, I got to have this comic now just because of the movie. No. I'm going to go enjoy it. I'll get the trade. So I know what I'm seeing comparing to the movies, but super dope that they are finally bringing this character around to getting some more play. Why he hasn't been, I guess, more in the comics recently, who knows? Because they've tried to do all these other black characters like Batwing and stuff like that that aren't really taking off either. So I don't think DC really knows where to go with black characters. They have Cyborg, but he's a half freaking robot with alien technology. You know what I mean? So it's like they don't know what to do with themselves. And the proposal of a black Batman or a black Superman has these white people out here bugging, like they are just going nuts. Like, you cannot do that. Superman's an alien.
Black.
Superman's an alien, you black. Asshole.
Why not? I mean, goddamn alien. They are black aliens.
You know, it's just ridiculous. Oh my gosh! So it's super dope.
Low key, I think. I mean, not even low key. Michael B. Jordan. We're starting to see him get to, now that he's in a position where he can nerd out. We're getting to see him nerd out. Yeah. So he did Black Panther, and he's working on Static Shock. He also did produced and was in Raising Dion on Netflix.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Which is basically a sci-fi movie. He's done a lot of sci-fi things. I think he's starting to show his, like, hey, man, at the end of the day, I'm a nerd, too. Like, I like sci-fi shit, and I would love to, you know, get to our level where we can have Michael B. Jordan on the show and just nerd out with him. Like, not talk about what everybody wants us to talk about. I'm like, oh, what was Rocky? And remember Creed? And nah, fuck all that. I want to nerd out with this dude. And be like, yo, man, you a nerd, ain't you? Yeah, man. You was rocking the Kanye backpack and the pink polo, wasn't you?
Don't forget, he was in that one where the meteor hits Earth or something like that. And like him and his four friends, they find it and they get these powers. So it's a very similar situation there. Early 2000s. People forget. And he was in Fantastic Four. He's played these superhero characters for quite some time. And, you know, and that one's actually a lot better film than people give it credit for. Because it gets real serious real fast. And it's like, what do you do if you gain powers? And there's a few that gain the powers. And then what do you do in one of those things? Oh,
Chronicle.
I can do whatever I want.
It was Chronicle. That's right.
Chronicle is that what it's called? Okay.
Yeah, it was Chronicle. I remember he was in it. I did like that. That was a good movie.
And actually, when I started watching Raising Dion, I thought maybe that was a follow-up to Chronicle because he had powers and now he had a child. But it's not. He got the powers a different way. But still, similar premise. A meteor shower, he gets powers, passes them on. Like, you know, similar. So he's been a nerd like this for quite some time. Yeah. You know, so it's cool to see this come around to now he has the money and the power and the fame to be able to put some of these things together. And the fact that he teamed up with Reginald Hudlin, a man who's like nearly twice his age, you know, and twice his experience, and twice the know-how on how to put these things together in writings and sequential storyline and all that. Like, that's amazing. People don't know Reginald Hudlin is big time. You know what I mean? Like, I think I've talked about him before. I love this man. I want to meet him one day.
Right.
Anyway.
I think he's going to be dope. Let's get into our what the shit moment. Our what the shit moment that we were discussing earlier.
That we had to save.
It's so 2020, bro. 2020, we've entered a completely different level of cancel culture. Like, I feel like between people being bored at home, being quarantined, not being entertained as much as they were before because people aren't able to make them and produce these films and TV shows and stuff to keep them distracted, people are just in their own heads and they're just all on the internet and people are losing their minds. There's been a running joke since Chris Pratt blew up on the scene in like 2016, 2015, like after he left Parks and Rec, when he started doing Guardians of the Galaxy, they were like, all right, the four Chrises. And the four Chrises were Chris, it was Chris Evans, obviously Captain America, Chris Hemsworth, Thor, Chris Pratt, Star-Lord, and then they kind of later added Chris Pine, not really because of Star Trek, but once he was in Wonder Woman. It was like, out of the four Chrises, how would you rate the four Chrises?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Been doing this shit for a while. And every once in a while, they'd be like, well, Chris Pratt's the worst because, you know, and so on and so forth. But something happened recently in 2020 where Chris Pratt, some lady tweeted like, all right, time to rate the four Chrises. And right at that time, Chris Pratt, who's been real kind of private about his personal life, like he was private about his divorce with Anna Faris. He was private about his marrying Arnold Schwarzenegger's daughter. He was private about a lot of his, like he doesn't really discuss politics or religion. But then he joined what is called, it's called the Zoe Church. He was a member of the Zoe Church.
That's not even the part I'm getting into. I don't even care about that part.
So he announced that he was a member of the Zoe Church and what's her name? Ellen Page from Juno and from the Umbrella Academy said the Zoe Church is anti-LGBTQ community. Like they don't like same sex anything. And so she said for Chris Pratt to say that he's a member of that means he supports that. And Chris Pratt was like, well, you know, I feel like they're open to everybody. And he kind of did that thing where he joined a group and then he let the world know about it. And now everything that group does, you have to be held responsible for because you are a celebrity. You are a big name in this group. Now you have to take responsibility and it sucks. So because of that, all these stars who know Chris Pratt have to take time out of their day to address trolls on the internet. Robert Downey Jr., as rich as he is, has to come out and explain how Chris Pratt is a good guy and he's a good friend of mine. And I've known Chris Pratt for so many years and he would never, he's such a good guy. And all these people have to come out and defend Chris Pratt's honor because he is the worst of four Chrises.
Yeah.
What the shit is happening that we in society give a fuck about the worst of four Chrises? And this dude joining a religion makes him the worst?
So, okay. So you're only looking at one really small aspect of it, okay? So I'm going to get into on this one a little bit because that's why I wrote it down as the second civil war within the MCU because I didn't put the whole note in there because it's not the MCU as in the Marvel cinema. It's the actors in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. So, yes, he joined this church, whatever. So people want to attach what they feel like the church does to him. He has come out and said, he has said publicly, I don't care what you do with your private lives. You want to get married, you want whatever. That's not, you know, that's none of my business. You know, I'm not sure if he said like, God still loves you. I still love you. Whatever. Who cares?
Somebody loves you.
So it was pretty great that all these other actors came out and said, yo, this man is stand up. He speaks from the heart. He's a stand up guy because he follows his morals and stuff like that. I appreciate that. The big thing is though, everyone was like, where was that response when the women of MCU were getting threatened, when the women of MCU were getting torn down or all, trying to be taken down because of their views, and in some cases of like Brie Larson, stuff she never even said. Right. You know what I mean? Like people were just attaching words, kind of like they, you know, like Hillary Clinton's a murderer of like 10,000 people, apparently, you know, it's like they're just attaching these things to them. Where was that defense? You know what I mean? And that's the big deal. That's why it's the second civil war, because everyone's like, wait, I didn't get defended like that. But all the guys defended Chris Pratt. You know what I mean? So what's up? There's just the inequality of the coming to the aid, to the rescue, to the word of these people, because all these women, just because they're in it and just because they're powerful women on screen, they get threats and they get, you know, talk shit about just because this, it doesn't even make any sense, you know, and we all know what was going on there. You know, we know what it is. It's sexist. Men have their own, like, oh, I'm so scared, even though she's a comic book character. You know, right. It's like, so, like, get over your fucking bullshit, man. You're so full of crap with that crap. So I appreciate them defending Chris. I think it's crazy that a joke went this far. You know what I mean? It's like, wait, this started off as a joke, and you just took it all the way this way. You know? So but, I appreciate that. But yeah, but my question is, yeah, where was that defense? Because these women had to fight with each other for each other, you know what I mean? But they didn't get much defense, and not that everyone didn't. Like Ruffalo, I believe, said stuff. I think Don Cheadle said stuff about, you know, these people coming after Brie Larson and stuff like that. And I appreciate that, but the amount of defense coming from Chris Pratt that didn't come out for these ladies is really, you know, not as fair. You know what I mean? Life isn't fair, but these are your co-stars. You know what I mean? These are fellow Avengers right. In life too, because they all are fighting for like the equality of people. You know what I mean? There, you know, so there's that.
We've already proven that, especially in Hollywood, men hold more value. We've already shown that. Because yeah, like you said with Brie Larson, people were losing their minds. Like Captain America cannot. I'm sorry, Captain Marvel cannot be stronger than. And people were like, dude, it's a comic book. Calm down. She can't be stronger. No. But then he's saying people are like, we got to do everything we can to protect Captain America's dick. Like those are the
that's right.
Same people. So yeah, this is not surprising me at all. It's just the fact that out of everything that's happening in 2020, that they're ready to cancel this dude because of the church he goes to and because he didn't address publicly who he's voting for. This is it's crazy. It's so definitely some what the shit. We are going to get up out your face.
Hey, one quick thing. People, I hope that you go and vote. I hope you listen to this while you're voting. Some of those lines out there taking 11 hours, 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours, 10 hours, whatever the hell it is, ridiculous. Okay. I hope we can give you some relief for at least close to an hour, whatever amount we took for this one, and then go back and listen to the other ones. Get into stuff that's not political. You know what I mean? So that you don't have to think about it while you're sitting there looking at these yahoos who might not be voting the same for you as you and may not care about equality and stuff like that you're trying to get. So please just get out there, do your thing, relax with it. You know, hopefully we can take your mind off these things a little bit.
I understand 2020 is crazy. And you, if you decide to go out to the polls to vote, you will run into some crazy people. You will run into some fanatics. I will give the same advice I always give. Just be smart. Be smart. There will be, if you are anti whatever Trump or Biden and you know somebody's in the line and they're talking all this, just be smart. Mind you, put the headphones on. Listen to OSP. We got you, baby. Yeah. Be distracted. Instead of listening to all this jibber jabber, just listen to us, man. We got you. We like you, baby. Appreciate you. So next time, I'm Sean Q. Be smart.
Jay Roman, we out.
Keep it old school.